For the first half of the 60s, LPs came out in radically different versions on different sides of the Atlantic. This was for a variety of reasons. Very often the UK releases had got there first, and so the US side were playing catch-up. There was also the fact that in the United States they preferred to restrict the number of tunes on a record for reasons of publishing royalties. And that's why records like this, Beatles 6, which never came out in the UK, but came out in the US, with its very distinctive advertising line there, the world's most popular foursome, John, Paul, George and Ringo, just in case you'd have forgotten, that wouldn't have happened in the same form in the UK. And this has got fewer tunes than its equivalent in the UK. But this changed all in 1966, 1967, with Blonde on Blonde and with Sgt. Pepper and so forth. And after that, records pretty much came out in the same form, both sides of the Atlantic. But they wouldn't always come out at the same time. They might come out months later, either side. So as a consequence, you've got a rich market building up for import records to supply the really keen fans during that period before a record came out in the UK. And this in Britain was centred on London, and in London it was centred in Soho, and in particular in shops like Musicland and Harlequin and One Stop and so forth, which would attract keen armies of browsers, of very earnest young, very often young men wearing suede jackets and smoking odoriferous French cigarettes, poring over the latest things from the States. And as the 60s turned into the 70s, they got increasingly excited about just looking at and feeling these records that they couldn't actually hear or own. You know, classic cases like this from the Flying Burrito Brothers, the Gilded Palace of Sin, or Happy Trails by the Quicksilver Messenger Service. These were the kind of records that were interestingly packaged in an aesthetic that seemed to call up a vanished America. And this particular thing, when taken together with the music, was had a very, very powerful effect on lots of British music fans. And none more so, no record had a greater effect than this one, of course, the second album by the band. And it had a lot of that effect, I do believe, was due to what it looked like as much as what it sounded like. And two of the earnest young men who used to browse most regularly in those shops were Bernie Taupin, 17, 18-year-old from Lincolnshire, and his new songwriting partner, Elton John. And this is in the time when Elton John was an underground prospect. He was edgy. He was out there. He was alt before any such thing was even thought of. And they were terribly inspired by these kind of records, those kind of records, and the early records of Leon Russell. And at that time, they hadn't really broken through. And so, interestingly, they came up with this record, which is a classic product of this era, Tumbleweed Connection, which was in many senses Elton John's breakthrough record. Hugely inspired by the band and Leon Russell and so forth. This is a record which is full of songs that could have come from America. Ballad of a Well-Known Gun, Talking Old Soldiers, Country Comfort, Burn Down the Mission, all that kind of thing. This record, fascinatingly, was conceived in Lincolnshire, if you like, written in Pinner, recorded in Wardour Street, and fascinatingly, packaged to look like a railway station out there on the frontier. This was actually shot on the Bluebell Railway in Sussex. Okay, so a greater case of what we now call cultural appropriation would be difficult to imagine. Of course, what's really amazing is when they took it to America, the Americans lapped it up. If you've ordered my book, either online or via your local bookshop, please get in touch with me via the email underneath this and send me your address, and I'll be happy to send you a signed, customised bookplate that you can put inside it. Thanks very much.